So, in our timeline in 1791, Meyer Rothschild had been given a charter to establish the first Bank of America. By 1811, this charter had expired and Congress voted against its renewal. Nathan Rothschild was not impressed and threatened. Either the application for the renewal of the charter is granted, or the United States will find itself involved in a most disastrous war. The United States stood firm, leading Nathan Rothschild to issue another threat that he would teach those impudent Americans a lesson. In 1812, therefore, backed by the money and wishes of Nathan, Britain declared war on the United States. The Rothschild plan was not to win the war for Britain, but simply to cause the USA to build up such a debt in fighting the war that they would have to allow the Rothschild Bank Charter to be renewed. This plan succeeded. In 1816, the Second Bank of the United States was established and given another 20-year charter. Thousands of British and American soldiers had died, but the Rothschilds got their bank. Around this time, the great patriarch of the family, Meyer Rothschild, died, leaving specific written demands for all those who would follow him. All the key positions in the Rothschild business interest were to be held by male family members only. The family was to intermarry with first and second cousins only as well. Many of these were arranged marriages. As well as preserving the purity of the bloodline, this would ensure that the family fortune would stay within their control. Consequently, of the 18 marriages by Meyer's children, 16 were with first cousins. Also, no public inventory of his estate was ever to be published. People were never to know just how wealthy and just how far-reaching their influence was becoming. The British war on America had proven very profitable, and so the Rothschilds repeated the trick by manipulating the Napoleonic Wars for their own ends. Nathan funded the Duke of Wellington through the Bank of England, while his brother James, who had been sent to Paris to start a central bank there, used their money to fund Napoleon. This war again generated massive risk-free debt for the Rothschilds. During the war, they also saw an opportunity to set up an unrivaled postal and courier service, who were to be allowed through both French and English blockades. It was these couriers who kept Nathan up to date with events, so that he could use that intelligence to manipulate the stock exchange. So good were these couriers that the news from the Battle of Waterloo was delivered to Nathan Rothschild a full 24 hours before Wellington's own courier. Being a day ahead of the curve, Nathan played a clever trick. At that time, British bonds were called consols, and upon hearing Britain had won the war, Nathan began selling all his consols. This made the other traders believe the British had lost the war, and in a frantic panic, they started selling too. The effect of this was that the consols plummeted in value. Nathan then discreetly told all his workers to start buying up the consols they could lay their hands on. When news came through that the British had in fact won the war the next day, the value of the consols skyrocketed, giving Nathan a 20-to-1 return on his investment. Feeling rather pleased with himself at this stage, Nathan made this famous statement: "I care not what puppet is placed on the throne of England to rule the empire on which the sun never sets. The man who controls Britain's money supply controls the British Empire, and I control the British money supply." He went on to brag that in the 17 years he had been in England, he had turned the £20,000 given to him by his father into £50 million, which is a huge sum by today's standards, let alone theirs. So powerful were the Rothschilds at this juncture that they used their control of the Bank of England to change the whole monetary system. Instead of shipping gold from country to country to pay for goods and services, which was costly and risky, they simply held the gold in their secure banks across the world and instead issued paper debits and credits. Now people only had to hand over a piece of official paper, which was backed by the gold held in secure locations. This is the origin of paper money that we have today. The past century had clearly been very profitable for the family. In fact, it became known as the Age of the Rothschilds, and it was by this point that some estimated them to own over half the world's wealth. These wars were also achieving gradual synthesis by the Hegelian principle. In 1814, the Congress of Vienna was called to settle the issues arising from the Napoleonic Wars, Vienna being the place where Salomon Rothschild had been posted. So out of the war of two sides, an attempt at synthesis was made. This became a model for the League of Nations and the United Nations, which would follow a century later after World Wars I and II respectively. The Vienna Congress was intended to create a blueprint for how a world government might be achieved. as many of the European countries were now in massive debt to the Rothschilds' bank because of these wars, they could use this as a bargaining tool. However, the Congress of Vienna was scuppered by Tsar Alexander in Russia, who did not yet have a central Rothschild-owned bank. Enraged by this, Nathan Rothschild swore to exact revenge on the Tsar's descendants. In 1817, the French took out massive loans to rebuild the country after the war. Rothschild agents then bought up vast amounts of French government bonds, causing their value to increase. On November the 5th, 1818, they dumped them all in the open market, causing their values to plummet and France to go into a financial panic. The Rothschild then stepped in to take control of the French money supply. In 1821, Kalman Rothschild was sent to Italy to do business with the Vatican and the Pope. By 1823, they had taken over the financial operations of the Catholic Church worldwide. In 1827, Sir Walter Scott published his works on the life of Napoleon. In volume 2 of the 9-volume set, he confirmed the French Revolution was planned by the Illuminati and that it was financed by the money changers of Europe, that being the Rothschilds. In 1832 in America, President Andrew Jackson ran the campaign for his second term in office under the slogan, Jackson and No Bank. This was in reference to his desire to take control of the American money system away from the Rothschild central bank and instead create a financial system that benefited the people. A year later, he stayed true to his word and started removing all deposits from their banks. This caused the Rothschild to panic and they contracted the money supply, causing a depression. Jackson knew what was going on and echoed Jesus' words when he declared, "You are a den of thieves and vipers, and I intend to rout you out, and by the eternal God, I will rout you out." On January 30th, 1835, a hired assassin tried to shoot President Jackson, but miraculously both his pistols misfired. President Jackson later claimed he knew the Rothschilds were behind the assassination attempt. The assassin himself, Richard Lawrence, later bragged that powerful people in Europe had hired him and promised to protect him if caught. Lawrence was indeed found not guilty by reason of insanity and escaped punishment. In 1836, Jackson finally succeeded in throwing the Rothschild Central Bank out of America when the charter was not renewed. In 1841, President John Tyler vetoed an attempt to reinstate the charter for the Bank of the United States. Following this act, he was sent hundreds of assassination threats. Benjamin Disraeli, future British Prime Minister, described Nathan Rothschild at this time as the lord and master of the money markets of the world and, of course, virtually lord and master of everything else. He literally held the revenues of southern Italy in pawn, and monarchs and ministers of all countries courted his advice and were guided by his suggestions. Disraeli also referenced these infamous occultists when he said, "The world is run by people very different to those that most people are aware of." In 1845, President Jackson died, but before his death he was asked what his greatest achievement was. His reply, "I killed the bank." In 1846, Meyer Rothschild's wife said nonchalantly from her deathbed that, "If my sons did not want wars, there would be none." In 1850, James Rothschild of France was said to be worth 600 million francs, 150 million francs more than all the other bankers of France put together. In 1861, Abraham Lincoln, 16th President of the United States, began printing his own debt-free money and informed the public it was legal tender for all private and public debts. By the following year, close to $450 million had been printed and distributed. Lincoln would say of this that, "We gave the people of this republic the greatest blessing they ever had, their own paper money to pay all debt costs." That same year, the Times of London said, "If that mischievous financial policy which had its origin in the North American Republic should become indurated down to a fixture, then that government will furnish its own money without cost. It will pay off debts and be without a debt. It will have all the money necessary to carry on its commerce. It will become prosperous beyond precedent in the history of the civilized governments of the world. The brains and the wealth of all countries will go to North America. That government must be destroyed, or it will destroy every monarchy on the globe." In 1865, Lincoln highlighted the danger of the money man, saying, "I have two great enemies, the Southern army in front of me and the financial institutions in my rear. Of the two, the one in my rear is the greatest." Later that year, Abraham Lincoln was assassinated. Following a brief period of training in the Rothschild London Bank, a man called Jacob Schiff, a Rothschild born in their house in Frankfurt, was sent to the United States with the task to regain control of the United States through a central bank. He was to find desirable men and promote them to high places in federal government. In 1875, Jacob Schiff took control of the major banking house, Kuhn Lubin Co., and formed associations with the other major bankers in the United States. In 1881, American President Garfield hinted at the way the Rothschild manipulated the money market, saying, "Whoever controls the volume of money in our country is absolute master of all industry and commerce. And when you realize the entire system is very easily controlled, one way or another, by a few powerful men at the top, you will not have to be told how periods of inflation and depression originate." In 1891, the British Labour leader made these statements regarding the Rothschilds. "This blood-sucking crew has been the cause of untold mischief and misery in Europe during the present century, and has piled up its prodigious wealth chiefly through fermenting wars between states which ought never to have quarrelled. Whenever there is trouble in Europe, wherever rumours of war circulate and men's minds are distraught with fear of change and calamity, you may be sure that a hook-nosed Rothschild is at his game somewhere near the region of the disturbance." Comments like these worried the Rothschilds, and towards the end of the century they bought the Reuters news agency to gain some control of the media, that is, the information flows. Reuters became a central source of news that supplied individual outlets around the world with news it wanted to be known.